So let's get started. So I got started by talking to my undergrad advisor, and I said, you know, I'd really like for my master's to do something related to international development. So I had gone to MIT, I was originally from Delaware. I thought, you know, hey, I went from this little tiny state to Boston, which is a little bit bigger. I would like to be able to do work, but I like to do it in a developing country and sort of serve third world countries. And so that's kind of what started this. And Alex, my professor, who's actually a professor of machine design of all things, happens to also be a farmer. They go together, of course. And he has bees on his farm. And he said, you know what? I got this idea. My bees struggle with wasps. And my wife hates it when yellow jackets go and they would attack her hives right in fall. And he said, you know what? What if you could solve this problem? He was very interested in this camera and laser system that would see wasps and zap them. It was very exciting. And in fact, in India has problems with wasps, but they're a lot bigger, they're more ferocious, they're scarier. And so we very graciously got funding to start looking at this problem of wasps and Indian beekeepers. And so that's how it started. Now, I was new to beekeeping, so this was a challenge for me, because not only did I have to learn a lot about the science and sort of this application, but I also had to really become a beekeeper. And so the first day I go to my advisor's farm, and the wife says, okay, take this box and just shake the bees into this hive. It was quite exciting. A lot of learning very, very fast. There was a lot of reading books. When you do this full time, you get to learn a lot. You read a lot of books, you go watch a lot of videos. You go and meet a lot of beekeepers. We had a lot of conferences in Massachusetts, actually, for beekeeping, like multiple ones a month. So there was a lot of things to go and see and really learn as fast as you can beekeeping, while at the same time trying to do some really meaningful research. It was interesting, though, because during the day, I was a normal U.S. beekeeper, but at night, I would be like Facebook messaging Indian beekeepers. And so one beekeeper, I said, oh, do you have a problem with wasps? And he's like, yes. We take shuttle rackets, which are essentially tennis rackets, and we just swat at them. I said, oh, you know, maybe this is a good thesis topic. So that's kind of how it started. I got to do 3 trips to India. These were not your normal like vacation trips. These were 3 to 4 weeks trips to rural places in India. So I was not staying so much in the cities, so much as places where only a couple people speak a little bit of English. And so usually traveling alone, but it was quite exciting. I was meeting not only the beekeepers, which I loved. I loved meeting the beekeepers. It was also hive manufacturers, NGOs, which are non-government organizations that work with beekeepers. There were government officials. They actually have a branch in their government focused on beekeeping, which is pretty cool. And my favorite was probably just the hive manufacturers, because as a mechanical engineer, these guys were the coolest. All right, so I'll keep going. So let me give just a really quick introduction as to why Indian beekeeping is so important. So 50% of the workforce in India is involved in agriculture. So in the US, I think it's like 1 to 2%-ish. India, it's 50%. Now there's a problem with this. And the problem is that every generation, the farmland that's available gets broken up amongst the sons. And so what used to be a reasonable thing, that you could have 50% of your people doing farmland, well, agriculture, now you have all these tiny plots. So you can see, just from the landscape, you have farmers that are trying to make a living on 1 acre. And this is not very sustainable. Unfortunately, there's not a lot of options. If you get an education, you can go and work in the city, but otherwise, you're really stuck kind of where you are. Beekeeping is so interesting, because it means that for these people that really don't have jobs and they really don't have land to work with, they can make a really sustainable income for themselves, and they don't need any farmland. So they will place their hives under trees, on the side of roads, wide variety of places, but it gives them a real occupation and allows them to sort of escape that cycle. So this is something that, for me, was really exciting and motivated a lot of what I did. So let me go and now switch over into a picture, or actually video, of some Indian beekeeping. So this was an Indian beekeeper. And so right off the bat, you might notice some interesting things. He's got, I think it's 9 or 10 frames. It's a Langstroth box, similar dimensions to what we have. It's actually the same bee. It's a European bee. Interestingly, they're wearing sandals while doing beekeeping. They're very brave. It's very hot. It's always very, very warm. You can see they were not using foundation in this case. You can buy foundation, but a lot of people, they'll just have empty frames of the bee sewed out. You notice there's a cloth that actually, it's dew cloth that they spread over on top of the hive, and that gets everything to seal a little bit nicer, provides a little bit more ventilation. They're actually very innovative in that you can use this cloth to pour water on top of it, and the water then can evaporate. So it's a way of actually getting the hive to stay cool. So it's pretty cool. One other thing that's interesting that I'll talk more is that the entrance size on the front is fixed. I did a lot of work at looking at hive entrances. And so this is a fixed size entrance. We usually have entrance reducers. We make them larger or smaller. They'd have a fixed size, and if they wanted it smaller, they could add mud, sort of plug it up and make it even tinier. So we'll talk a little bit more about it. If you guys do have any questions as we go, feel free to stop me, and I'll try to answer them. So moving forward, this is another part of India. This was in the southern part of India. They use the Indian bee that's more native. And it's a smaller bee, doesn't produce as much, but when they tried to introduce a European bee into the southern parts of India, had a lot of disease. And so this is a smaller bee, you won't get as much honey, but they love to color their boxes, all kinds of pretty colors. And you can see some sort of Indian things, like for example, the roof of one of the beehives is actually a tile. They just said, I need a roof, and they made do. So it's very, very, very resourceful in general. If I look at sort of a comparison of all hive types, I just mentioned sort of the normal Langstroth hive of the Indian beekeepers. It's really a Langstroth hive, but it's for the Apis cerana, which is the Indian bee. You'll also find in different regions, so in the Himalayas, I saw folks that had wall hives, which is like the inside of their walls. They cut them away, and they put up boards and seal them with mud, and the bees actually will have a hive inside their house, which is pretty cool. And also mud hives, there's also log hives. One of the things though that I was very curious on, that I got some insight into over the course of my time, was why the boxes aren't stacked so high. So when I was working with my advisor, we'd have really, really tall hives with lots of boxes. Our goal was to get them as big as we could, harvest as much honey as we could from each one. In India, you find a lot of small hives, and I wanted to understand why that is, and we'll talk more about that. If you have looked into Indian beekeeping though, you may have heard of like honey hunters, the people that climb up trees with knives and like carve out honey. That deals with, in particular, the Apis dorsata. So they have, this kind of bee has one comb, and then they just layer themselves on the outside to keep it warm and defend it. They cluster together, they're very ferocious. If they feel attacked, they will come and they will like really hurt you. So I didn't work with these bees, but I did get to see them. One of my beekeeper friends said, hey, we gotta go. We hopped on his motorcycle, which was exciting. And we went out there and we got to see, I think this had the record for like the most Apis dorsata bees in at least part of India. And it was pretty impressive. Okay, there is a smaller bee. This is the Apis floria. Again, I wasn't working with a lot. This isn't commercialized, but you'll see them and they like to hang a little bit smaller. This was just in a bush. The beekeeper was like, oh, look, we have more bees over here. And I was like, oh my goodness, in this bush, you can actually see them just hanging on a limb, which is pretty cool. All right, so I'm gonna transition now into the actual research that I did. I gave you a little bit of context, a little bit of images and video to see what beekeeping is. My research, again, was broken into lots of little pieces, and it started with wasps, and then it quickly evolved into a lot of different areas. So let me give you a sort of diagram of my research and kind of the flow. So it started with saying, okay, I'm going to start by looking at wasp, and that got sort of broken up into how do I identify wasp, and then how do I kill wasps or stop them, because I did not want wasps to attack with beehives. And that kind of evolved in some crazy technological like audio analysis, video analysis, and then the very, you know, obvious realization, well, this would be great for the professor's wife who would pay a lot of money to zap a wasp, but that wasn't an appropriate technology for India. And so I started to look on sort of the stopping wasp side into shocking wasps, which is pretty cool. I have some video of that, into entrance design, which became a main theme of my research. And this kind of evolved into an academic focus of when I was trying to do experiments, I wanted to weigh hives. I realized they were not good at hive scales, so I got to do a lot of calculus, analyzing hive scales, which is interesting. I took a fluid dynamics course, so I got to look at fluid dynamics of beehives, and there's some cool takeaways from there. And then just from visiting India, there was all these apparent like you know what, we should do this really simple test and we should learn something very specific that's very actionable. And so three things that came out of it, we're looking at beehive roofs, looking at the standard and design and manufacture of Indian beehives, and then lastly, I spent some time looking at some ways of that beekeepers in India could keep better care of their hives with managing how they were doing over time. So it evolved a lot. So I'm gonna break it down into sort of the five key areas that I mentioned before. So let's start out with identifying wasps. Bees and wasps make different sounds, and if you do what's called a fast Fourier transform, which is kind of like that spectrogram analysis, okay, bees and wasps flap at different rates, and so you can actually very distinctly hear a difference. If I just play two audio files. There's a good chance that the beekeepers in this room could identify, yes, that sounds like a wasp, and no, that doesn't. So it was very interesting. In fact, there was a Indian bee researcher who told me a story. He said, you know what, I even met a beekeeper that he went on vacation for 3 days. He came back and his entire apiary was wiped out from these wasps that came in and they just decimated his entire apiary. Okay, so if there was a device that you could just stick and it could figure out, oh my goodness, I hear wasps, and send you a text message, it almost could be something useful for you. It could let you know, hey, I need to come back. I can't be away. There's actually a wasp in the air. I need to come home. I also looked at video analysis and trying to figure out, you know, how could you track them? Because my advisor really, really wanted a laser zapping mechanism. It would have been awesome, and it would have been possible. That was one of the interesting takeaways. It is possible with the developments. You know, you think of self-driving cars. The technology that's going into that says it's very, very possible to make a laser thing that zaps wasps. It's just not necessarily the appropriate technology for India. Here we go. So I did have an undergraduate help me, and so one of the things we got to do was I said, all right, I wanted him to make a lovely bee counting thing, because I did a lot of tests counting the number of bees that went in and out of hives. So his first step, and only step, but it was a good first step, was figuring out how much of the bees sort of covered an entrance. So we could take a picture of a hive, and we could estimate the actual area that the bees covered. And so you could say, how much are bees bearding on the front of a hive, and get a quantitative measure for that, which was something that was pretty cool. Unfortunately, that's all that got, and so I ended up having to do a lot of manual bee counting, which is a little bit of work. So let me switch over into sort of stopping wasps. So one of the things I thought was, how cool would it be if you could shock the wasp? Okay, lasers, that's a little high tech. Why not just be able to shock them? And so this was one of my favorite prototypes. It's very simple. A fifth grader could have made it, but it was beautiful. And what I did was I had an electric bug zapper. I tied it to two metal strips. I had my camera, and I just waited until a wasp landed on it. So here's these metal strips. You're looking down. There's a wasp. It's hard to see, but he is like right there. That's the wasp right there. And he ends up landing, or she, I don't know. But in any case, then I pressed the button and I zapped it for a good 6-7 seconds, because I did not want this wasp to live. And my advisor's wife was standing like right away from the beehive. And I learned something very important. Want to take a guess what that is?
Killed a lot of bees at the
same time. I killed a lot of bees, yeah. I killed bees, yeah. And I only killed probably like 5 to 10 bees, okay? But the beekeeper was very against this idea, because all the bees started running out. They were not happy. They were like, what has gone on? They were not too happy. Now, there's actually some interesting motivation for this. The wasps in India are longer, so it's less likely bees would get stung all the time. And bees, this was probably at 1 to 2,000 volts. Bees actually can feel stings as low as 1 volt. So it would be very interesting if you could have a very low voltage system that didn't kill bees, and maybe didn't kill wasps, but would deter them. Something that's very interesting. I didn't get to make it, but I always wanted a robber screen that used a mechanism like this to deter the robbing bees. Be very, very interesting. So that was shocking wasps. But I only got so far in it, in part because as soon as it got cold, there were no wasps, which was a little frustrating. And when I went to India, guess what? There was no wasp because they only come in certain seasons in certain regions. And so I decided to sort of evolve what I was doing into something that dealt with the issue of wasps, but also dealt with a lot of other issues. And that was looking at bee entrances. How many of you have one of these on your hives? Okay, good. You have an entrance reducer. And it's very interesting. My advisor said, okay, or my advisor's wife said, well, whenever I have a wasp problem, I go and I get the smallest entrance possible. Okay, and that tries to make it so the bees can defend themselves bigger. And the idea was bigger entrances are harder to defend, but they let bees in and out faster and it has a little more ventilation. The smaller entrances make it so the bees can defend themselves bigger, well, better. But they don't really like these tiny entrances. And I have a picture, and if you look closely, you can see where the bees have started to eat away this entrance. They really don't like the tiny entrances. And so I wanted to answer the question, well, what is the optimal entrance? This obviously has a lot of math done to figure out what the size is. And the beekeepers ourselves do a really great job of like, oh, I probably should have put on that entrance reducer. We don't spend a lot of time thinking of what is the optimum size. In India, they had a different kind of entrance reducer on some hives. It was a little bit bigger, it was actually easier. You didn't have to like pull in and try to pull it out. It kind of sat in front, which was a kind of cool design. And so I started looking at hive entrances in general. One of the main things I wanted to understand was just what size entrance is most appropriate in terms of width. So I did a really simple experiment and where I had an entrance and I kept progressively making it smaller and smaller. It was on a hot day. And I looked and I ended up having to do the bee counting of how many bees went in and out, which took a lot of time. But what I found very interestingly was that small entrances don't really stop bees from going in and out all too much. But what happens is when it gets too small, you stop having the ventilation you need. And so ventilation becomes a bigger problem than the traffic flow of bees going in and out of a beehive. And so that was a pretty cool conclusion because it says I need to worry more about ventilation than bees going in and out. Yeah. Now, I was not particularly happy with this conclusion though. Because I had worked super, super hard on counting bees. So I did a more interesting thing. I very quickly took the same data set and I asked the question, well, I want to find something interesting. What's interesting in my data set? And I found that bees tend to follow each other. So if you have, imagine there's like one door and you have people trying to run in and out and in and out. What happens is somebody sort of barges through and then people behind kind of follow through. And then if you want to go the other way, somebody kind of pushes through, and then the other bees in this case kind of follow through. And so there is a slight tendency in what would otherwise normally be called a geometric series that the bees kind of follow each other. So that was interesting. So I got to do some other really simple experiments, similar to this bee counting. One of them was looking at what's the appropriate entrance height. And so I sort of had one like tall, like a tall entrance, small entrance, tall, small. And I ended up counting like what do bees like. It turns out very simply, the taller entrances will use more, probably because bees just go to the quickest thing that they can find. It wasn't revolutionary, but it was interesting because I had a lot of bees that were exiting on the tall hives, and if I looked very carefully, they were usually crawling upside down on their way out. So when they left the hive, they sort of leave on the closest entrance. Going in, it was sort of more of a uniform distribution of which entrance they went through. So that was something interesting.
So what about screen bottom boards for ventilation, and then you can keep the entrance small?
I think that is a great idea. I did not get to do like rigorous testing on that, but I would highly recommend that, yes. Especially for India, which is not something they're doing now. It's something that I put in to say, in your standard, you should start encouraging those. I did get to have some fun making sort of automatic bee entrances. So this was a design that had a little valve that opened up and closed. I wanted to do an experiment where you could just adjust it over time, maybe have some heat sensors. Didn't get too involved with it. I did find something very cool though, and that is if you go very, very slowly, it's like a garage door. If it's going fast, you'll run for it. If it goes slowly, you eventually decide, you know what, I'm not going to do the limbo, I'll go around. And so the slower you went, the less likely the bees were to get crushed.
So they're not daredevils?
They're not super daredevils at a point,
okay.
which was interesting. And then I made a more stylish design that's a helical design that was fun to 3D print that was more continuous. So you can imagine you have a really simple servo, and you could have something that adjusts Oh, it's hot right now, I'm gonna open up. Oh, it's cold, I'll sort of close back down. You can have a little microphone that says, oh, I hear wasps, adjust for the time of day and things. So it was cute, it was interesting. It was a little bit out of the price point for India. Part of the thought was, in addition, you have a lot of commercial beekeepers that might need to close up all their hives when there's a pesticide application. Okay, so we spend a lot of money on hives, often just for fun, but even for commercial beekeepers, if you had a system where you press a button, all your hives close, you can cut the grass, maybe not, it would be interesting. For India, I was thinking, well, wouldn't it be a little more appropriate just to say, go buy your hives, open and close them. And so I actually, it was a very simple design. This was a wedge design. It would slide in the front to be a little bit more robust. There are things that have a very strict tolerance. It either doesn't fit or it slides in and out very easily. So it's a little bit nicer, easier to make. But one of the issues with it was I tried to do an experiment with beekeepers and I said, you know, hey, could you do this experiment where during the day, if it's hot, you open up more, if it's cold, you close, and they said, well, we really can't do that. I said, why is that? And the reason why was because they would often have to migrate their bees to different areas, and they might live 2 or more hours away from where their hives were actually staying at any point in time. And because of that, they couldn't easily get to their hives to make little adjustments. That just wasn't something that was possible. Now, I did go and say, well, what if the bees could do that? So I made some little designs, these are very cute, where bees would open and shut doors. Bees are not very smart, unfortunately. As much as I love them to be, collectively they can be very interesting, but individually they're not very smart. Bumblebees, though, this was inspired by bumblebees, that there's a special entrance for bumblebees where they can lift flaps. You can watch YouTube videos on it, and it helps to stop wax moths from getting into bumblebee hives. But it didn't really work for little bees. They're not very strong, unfortunately. They're not as strong as bumblebees, and I'm not sure that they were quite as bright. But I did get to make some other cool entrances. One of them I call a hex reducer. It's very interesting because there's not just like 2 entrances, but 3, or actually 4 if you take it out fully. And so you actually, instead of just having 2 very discrete sizes, you get an actual 3rd in between, which is kind of cool. And it looks pretty awesome. And because I had to print a mouse sort of blocker on the shape of honeycomb. Every beekeeper I saw loved these too. So they're in the public domain. If you want to make them, I will even buy them from you because they're pretty cool.
Did it work though? Did the honeycomb mouse reducer work?
Sure. The bees loved it. They were going in and out all the time.
Yeah. Very cool.
Now, my favorite, well, the best experiment I did with entrances actually got inspired from talking to an Indian beekeeper. And I went up and I was asking a lot of beekeepers. I asked this one guy, how do you determine the size of your entrance? And he said, well, what I do is I take some paper, I crumple it up, and I shove it in the front of the entrance, and they eat away the entrance until they find what size they want.
Ooh.
It's a very good idea, right? And I would encourage you, if you're curious, you know, open up if you have a small hive, get a little bit bigger, crumple up some paper, see what they eat out. And so I said, well, that sounds like a wonderful experiment that I can do while I'm in India. So I taped graph paper from my notebook onto the front of a hive, and I measured what do they eat in just 24 hours or so, in one day. And so we had a very small Indian hive that was, there's all just one box for the most part, but this only had a few frames. It didn't eat out almost anything. A medium-sized one that had like 6 to 8 frames, but not really filled, ate out just a little bit. A beaming one box that really should have been super though, ate out their entire front entrance. And they can't eat out anymore because it's wood. They have a fixed size entrance and it really should have been bigger. And so one of the cool conclusions was, well, if you want to have bigger hives that get more honey, you need to have bigger front entrances because your bees obviously want it. For a US for comparison, this was a 3 medium hive. They ate out most of the entrance in just one day. And then for a large 3 deep hive, they ate out the entire thing. They probably would have loved a lot more. They would have loved screen bottom board. That would have been excellent. But it was something that was very interesting to see, very quantitative and very actionable, saying, hey, hive manufacturers, you should make the hive entrances bigger for Indian hives. That was a cool experiment. So that's enough about entrances. Let's move into hive roofs. So I tried to get an experiment with like with Indian beekeepers on, you know, adjust the size of your entrances. That didn't work, but hey, I had a connection, had an NGO that was working with me. I had three beekeepers that each had 100 hives or more. And I said, well, let's do an experiment. We'll do it in India, however you can, we'll make it happen. And so we looked at adding sort of an extra layer to the roof. So when I went to India, I saw a lot of hives. They were out in the sun. The sun was baking on them. The poor bees, they were probably overheating because it was really, really hot, especially on the hives, the roof surface. What if you had a layer of shade? And just to put this in context, you might say, why don't Indian beekeepers just move their hives into shade? Well, when you move your hives, you have to do it at night, okay? Many of them aren't using GPS when they go and drive these trucks that they rent, maybe by the hour, okay? And so they're moving them in at night. They're trying to place them on a field or under trees. They might run out of space, and they might need to put some hives in the sun. And so this was a way of like, what if you had just an extra metal sheet that went on top that was elevated and sort of gave localized shape? And we also looked at sort of bamboo roofs as sort of another way of doing this. So I looked at this, but there was a problem. Within the first week, one of the beekeepers called and said, somebody came by and stole all of my metal roofs. But this was not going to end up working. So I went over, we did what we could, but I learned a ton of really interesting things from doing this experiment. One of the things that was very interesting was I prescribed to them, I want you to buy aluminum roofs, because that's what we use. Most of our hive roofs in the US are made out of aluminum. And aluminum is highly reflective. It absorbs only about 15% of sunlight. But when I went there and I talked to them, I said, okay, you know, how are things going? You know, got the materials, what happened? They said, well, we actually got iron roofs. That's what we use. We use iron roofs. Iron absorbs 60 to 90% of incident sunlight. So it looks similar. It feels like metal. It's waterproof. But it's very different in that it absorbs so much more sunlight. And so one of the things that was very, very easy to do is we went to a paint store. There were a number of paint stores. We said, okay, give me two colors of paint. We got a blue paint. We got a white paint. And we took some roofs and we laid them down and we just painted them. And then I had a temperature sensor I brought and I just measured the temperature. And just painting the roofs that you thought were reflective but they weren't, white, reduced the sort of contact temperature by about 5 degrees Celsius, which we don't know is about 10 degrees Fahrenheit. So that's a really, really big deal. And so the recommendation was, it looks pristine, being metal, but you should go and paint all of the beehives in India, the roofs white, which is very interesting. We also came up with a different way of sort of localized shade that was a little bit cheaper. This was a material that they use for, you know, getting rid of weeds and things. Very common, very cheap. Take two sticks, you have some staples on the side or nails, doesn't damage your hive in any way, and gives you a localized shade. You can take the sticks out, then you can stack boxes when you need to migrate. So it's a pretty simple thing. So when I was taking courses, I wanted to take courses that overlapped with beekeeping. It's hard to do sometimes when you study machine design and things. But one of the courses I got to take was fluid dynamics. Fluid dynamics were extremely hard for me. They were extreme, like the class was ridiculously mathy. It really was. But we had a major, like one main project. And so the project that I did was the simplest project that could ever be possible. It was flow air over a box and look at what happens. That was my topic. But it was extremely well motivated and there were a lot of really cool things. So this is air flowing over a beehive, simulated. You can see how the air sort of disconnects, kind of goes around and sort of cycles back. And there were two things that I learned from this that were very, very interesting and are relevant for also Wisconsin beekeepers. I'm gonna zoom in and then we'll jump forward.
Like an overview of it, or is this like a head-on side?
This is like a cut, so air is blowing 1 meter per second towards the front of a hive. I've chopped it down the center. The arrows represent the direction of flow and the colors represent the velocity in this case. I should discuss
this. Are you looking at from the side of the elevation?
So yes, so this is like, I'm facing my hive and I've cut it down the center, and this is a 2D projection. Yeah. One of the very cool things you can look at, though, is the pressure. Pressure is very easy to, it's always calculated in fluid flow. And so one of the cool things is when you have air incident on the front of a beehive, you end up having high pressure, which is shown in red on the front face, and you have very low pressure on the back face. Now, if you look at the magnitude of what that is, which I probably could have done by first order calcs, because it's a very simple conservation of energy, that you have air moving with a velocity that has kinetic energy, and it goes and gets converted into pressure and stored in that kind of energy. But one of the cool things that comes out of this is you can say a lot about how air flows through a hive based on how the air flows around a hive. And so here's why. How many of you have upper entrances on your beehives? Almost everybody. Okay, great. So what I learned from this is that if you have an upper entrance that's in the front of your hive, the internal flows that are going to happen are going to be due to buoyancy. And the reason why is because you have the same pressure or same gauge pressure at the bottom of your bottom entrance as your top entrance. However, if you have your top entrance on the back of your hive, then you're going to be susceptible to all kinds of wind gusts. And the wind gusts are going to be what dominate what happens in the inside, like the internal flows of your beehive. So in cold climates especially, which also happens in India in different regions, you want to make sure that you have your front, top entrance facing the front of your hive. And that way it's going to occur due to buoyancy and not due to wind gusts. And that's something, so this winter, put your front entrance, well, your top entrance on the front. Yes?
You're saying towards a prevailing wind.
No. It's a good question. The reason why is because you have the reverse if the wind comes in the other direction. So if it comes in, if the wind's coming this direction, the air is going to flow. If you have a back entrance, it's going to flow up and out. If you have wind in the opposite direction, then you'd have air that would flow down and through. So it, regardless of the orientation of the wind, and there's a lot of other pictures of like diagonal flow and horizontal flow, in general, it's going to be best to have your front entrance or your top entrance in the front.
So it means top entrance on the same side as your
Yes, right. Yes, which is also in the front, but yes. Yes, I see two hands, yes.
So if you're going to ventilate just by lifting the lid slightly,
yep.
You should lift the lid at the front of the hive rather than the back.
Yes,
hive.
If you're trying to make it so that wind gusts don't affect the hive a lot. There's some cases where you would want like lots of extra airflow, but in general you want it powered by buoyancy and by the bees themselves. So I'm gonna talk about the second thing I learned from fluid dynamics. This was when I was in India and I was noticing that a lot of the hives were painted very interesting bright colors. There's nothing wrong with bright colors, but they're not white. And white absorbs the least amount of sunlight in general. And you have bee hives that are out in the sun. I was very worried about the bees because they have to thermoregulate themselves and do extra work to keep the hive cool. And I said, well, why are the hives painted these colors? And I got different answers, so I can't say for certain. One of the answers that was very interesting was some of the beekeepers said, well, if one level of government subsidizes our hives, they say we have to paint it this color. If another level of government says they're going to subsidize the hive, they got to paint another color. And so they had five different standardized colors for the different levels of government. Another theory is that the beekeeper said, I want my hives this color, and so that's what they got. But the problem is it's not white. And so you have beehives that are getting extra sunlight than what they actually need. So one of the cool things was that I looked at how heat gets wicked away from the hive surface. It was very simple. It's again air flowing over a box. But on this left, I have not a painted beehive, but a diagram, a fluid dynamics diagram, where the color represents how easy it is for heat to get wicked away from a hive surface. Where it's red, and green, which is on the edges and the corners, heat gets wicked away very, very fast. On the hive faces, the heat doesn't get wicked away as fast. And so what it means, very interestingly, is that you can paint the edges and the corners of your hives any color you want. It's not going to affect the thermodynamics of what's going on. But you should paint the hive faces and the roof, you should paint that white. This does not mean that you have to paint it this way. An easier and a better way that I ended up recommending to beekeepers was paint your whole hive white, and then you can paint that front strip any color you want. You can paint it black. It doesn't matter. You can paint it any color, but paint the rest of your beehive white. And so that way, ideally, levels of government can say, I want it pink or blue or green, whatever color you want. But the rest of the hive will stay cool because it's painted white. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, so now I'm gonna try, I have a thesis chapter on this, but it's a little complicated. I'm gonna show a graph of sort of high fluid dynamics. It's theoretical. It's not like I didn't experiment for this, but I'm hoping it conveys why keeping hives cool is so important. So bees, they have four main ways that they can affect the ventilation of hives. They can either evaporate water, more or less water, so that sometimes they forage water. Sometimes they're fanning honey or nectar to get it, and that sort of evaporates water. When you evaporate water, things cool down. Another thing is generating more heat. So that can be bees vibrating in place. That can be on hot days, your bees will leave the hive and you have less heat generation inside your hive. You can exchange air with the outside. So that can be bees that are fanning at the entrance, trying to blow more air through the hive. That acts as like a heat exchanger. And then you have heat through the surfaces, which is, again, where you have sunlight. It's beating down on your hive surface. Your hive surface is hot, and that's conducting heat into your hive. Unfortunately, I can show using theory that bees can only cool their hives so much. So if it gets extremely hot, the bees can't cool their hives, and this is important because bee brood has to stay cool enough for them to develop correctly. There's a lot of research that has gone into that. And so I wanted to sort of give a motivation for why you really want to keep hives cool enough in hot areas and do everything you can to keep them cooler. So this is a graph. It's a level gas. It's called a psychrometric chart. And it's kind of like what a weatherman might use. I'll talk about the axes first. So on the bottom, we have temperature in Celsius. Sorry, that's probably not very helpful for you guys. But we're like 30... Does anybody want to convert from Celsius to Fahrenheit?
36 degrees.
Perfect. All right, so 34-ish is probably in the upper 90s in Fahrenheit. So we have temperature along the bottom. And then along the top, we have what is called specific humidity, which is the grams of water per sort of, I think, unit volume. In this case, it's per unit mass of air. And then these red lines that sort of curve up are the relative humidity. Okay? And you notice that they're curved. You can only add so much water to air before it's saturated. And that's why you can't go above 100% humidity. Now, there's four different arrows that I have here that correspond to the four mechanisms where bees can cool or heat up their hives. One of the methods is, let's say this point right here is the inside of your hive. This is sort of the equilibrium operating conditions inside your hive. Now the bees can do four things. The first thing they can do is they can vibrate in place. If they vibrate in place, they add heat to the hive, and that can be represented by an arrow to the right. They can also evaporate water. If you evaporate water, you move up diagonally to the left. So you're cooling the hive, but you're also adding water. If there's a hive surface temperature that's different, you're gonna conduct heat. So in this case, the hive surface is cooler than the inside of the hive, so that's an arrow to the left. And then you can exchange air with the outside, and that's represented by, this is the outside conditions, and so I have an arrow going down to the left. You can imagine these as forces. They have to balance to have equilibrium within a hive, and so you have different relative amounts of one to the other to be able to keep internal hive conditions stable. That was a lot of jargon. But what is important, and you can actually see this, thankfully, on this presentation, this region right here that's sort of darker is sort of the area where bees could keep the inside of their hives. If they could either keep exchanging air with the outside to sort of pull the internal conditions more towards whatever the outside temperature is, or they could add a lot of heat by vibrating in place, move off to the right, they can evaporate and go this way. So this is lovely conditions. If they're staying at a little over 60% relative humidity, at about 34°C, they're happy bees. This is a great condition. On the other hand, if it's a warmer day, then they have to work harder, and it's harder for them to keep the same conditions. So in this case, the air outside is hotter than what the bees actually want. And so the only thing that they can do in this case to keep the hive cool is to forage a lot of water and try to evaporate it. So in this case, they really don't want much air flowing through the hive with the outside because it's only gonna heat things up. But they have to do a little bit to counteract the evaporation because they're gonna have to evaporate a lot of water. And in addition, you want the least heat conduction through the outside hive surface. So this would be a representative case for India. It's one of those cases where you want the least amount of incident sunlight hitting your hive to keep your hive cooler. I'll give you one more example. This is not a good condition. This is what happens when it's super, super hot. Your bees have run out on the front because they are trying to minimize as best as possible the heat generation inside your hive, because they literally cannot physically, they physically, thermodynamically cannot cool the hive as much as they need to really protect the brood. And so this is one of the reasons, it's a motivation as to why keeping the hive white, keeping it in shade, keeping it cooler is extremely important for hives in India that are in hot regions, because they literally physically cannot cool themselves. That was something interesting. Okay, I'm gonna move on to some simpler stuff. If you have any questions on this, come and talk to me afterwards. Love to talk to you more. So let's talk a little bit about hive design standards and manufacturing. When I was in India, the hive standard and quality was just not quite the same. These were some hives that were in not good condition for disrepair, but hives out in the field often look this bad. So often you see frames that they'd be warped. You see boxes that have holes in them. Lots of challenges just in the beehive box manufacturing and design. Interestingly though, where we show out a lot of money for our beehives, maybe $200 or more a piece, they can buy a beehive for $11 and then it gets a 50% subsidy. So it's a little bit, I mean, take your pick. It's a pretty nice deal for the cost for a beehive. They're just often not in very good conditions. One of my favorite things was going actually visiting the hive manufacturers. This was one of the hive manufacturing places. Lots of interesting things. You don't see a lot of squares. You don't see a lot of levels. But you do see a lot of handwork. Okay.
The frames going like this.
Yeah.
Yeah. Handwork?
Did I see handwork?
Yes, you don't see a lot of levels or squares, but you see a lot.
A lot of work by hand.
Okay.
And so there's a guy on the back. He's painting. You have somebody who's sanding one of the edges. You see a lot of pretty boxes, but they're not perfectly all the same size, which is interesting. Yes?
What kind of wood do they use? Is it green?
So it was very interesting. I didn't know a lot about wood going into this. Some of it was teak, I think. Some of it was, I don't remember the other kinds. I'll have to look it up. But they would use whatever was normally inexpensive. For the frames, they might go with a better wood. Because the frames, you have to have them, they're thinner, they have to be a little harder. And then they would actually leave the wood out to dry and sort of get into a state where it'd be better to use them. It was interesting because this other hive manufacturer, I don't have a picture of it right now, but he had a big like plot of land where he just had wood out to dry. He'd cut it himself, he'd start with logs, he'd cut it himself, he'd put it out, he'd have it dry, and then he would cut it in even smaller pieces, and then he'd build right from that. There's a lot of interesting things to go into how they made the hives, like just in sort of the process. So this particular thing is a hive roof. These are your hive roofs, Janet. And one of the things that they did was they'd have slightly longer pieces and they'd nail it all down and then they'd come by very quickly and cut off the sides to make it nice and square. Okay, so it's not quite square, but it fits together.
Kind of.
But it was $11 a hive, so you know.
What is the consumption of honey in India?
It's lower than in the U.S. in the sense of like per capita. Indians don't eat a lot of honey. They view it more as a medicine. If we could convince Indians and we started an ad campaign that like honey was the best thing for bread and for toast and for everything else, the prices of honey would go up a lot because there's 1 billion. Than honey eaters.
The reason I ask my question is, I sell at a farmer's market.
Okay.
It's in an area that there is quite a bit of ethnic diversity.
Yep.
And I've never sold honey to a person from India.
Yes. So the perception in general there is that it's a medicine, and that's why it gets exported more than sold locally. Yep. It's a good question. So this was part of the hive manufacturing. One of my favorite things was I actually got to go through and say, okay, these are points that you could improve to make things work better, save money even, which the hive manufacturer is very excited about. You did see a lot of beekeepers making their own equipment, whether that's just simple repairs or making it themselves. So again, that's making it such that things aren't always the same size. I want to go back to this question. which was, why are hives not always supered? There's a lot of answers. One of them is that the hive boxes don't fit particularly well on top of each other. It's an unfortunate consequence. The one guy, I saw a couple of supered hives. They would stick the boxes, they'd seal them with mud, they might take nails and kind of nail them together. It's not a great system when you want to have big hives. They weren't really made for that. But there's a lot of really cool cost-effective things. So one is the stands for that. They don't have to have these big rugged stands because they don't have big hives. They're very easy to lift relative to our hives. You would not probably need help, Janet, because you could lift these.
Oh, yeah. I mean, would go today dropping out of the box.
It would be good. But in addition, I don't think all the Indian beekeepers really, when I showed them a picture of like, okay, this is the hives I've been working with, they had never seen hives so big. Okay, because that's just traditionally not what they've seen before. So part of it was awareness. One of the interesting things that I got to do for my thesis though was I ended up going through a paywall and paying money to get the official Indian Hive Standard. And it was a slightly older document. Unfortunately, the specifications for what the standard size of Indian beehives are supposed to be, unfortunately they conflict. And so there is no good Indian Hive Standard for all of India. And this is a problem, so part of my thesis was writing out, okay, these are the standards that conflict, these are the things you could focus on, one of them being the screen bottom board, that would be a lovely thing they could add if they're updating it. And starting with that, but then also starting on the demand side, because I talked to a hive manufacturer who said, I would love to make a standard size beehive, but my beekeepers say, I want 7-frame hives. And so that's what I have to build, because I have to get paid. So part of it was, let's go and try to get from the government route, try to get a official Indian Hive Standard. Then also, there's this part of going to the grassroots level, getting the beekeepers to want like hives that are going to stack well, that they know what the right size, and working from there. So lots of aspects of that. Yes?
So the question is are the frames standard? Obviously, the boxes are different, but are the frames standard?
Frames, well, they should be. One of the problems is that you have a lot of frames that are a little bit too long or too short, so they'd have to sort of swap between boxes. And that's a pain point, especially for these beekeepers that have to migrate their boxes. So yes, it should be standardized. In practice, it's not perfect. And it's something that is definitely a pain point for the beekeepers.
Are they migrating to follow the blossom?
Yes, they do. When this is your income, you move the bees wherever they gotta be. One thing to note about this that was very interesting, so we heard recently about the big pesticide kill in the Carolinas. I want you to imagine though, like most beekeepers, for me, I have to think about one plot, because I'm on kind of a secluded farm area. I have to think about that one person applying pesticides. Many of the commercial beekeepers, you put your hives on somebody's farm, you might have to think about a couple people and remind them not to apply pesticides. Remember back to how I said there's lots of little farm plots? The foraging mine was still 1 mile radius, and so they are constantly hit with the beekeeper down the road, not the beekeeper, but the farmer down the road decided to apply pesticides, and I have to deal with 50 of them, and maybe 40 of them understand not to apply pesticides too heavily, but that one farmer really hurt me. And so that was one of the things that actually came out of the experiment. Why is the honey going down? He said, well, the con farmer decided to apply pesticides. So it's very interesting. There's a question. Yes?
I was just going to ask about the quality of the variations in quality. Does that affect the bee space and the length strength is based on the bee space? Did you see any problems with it?
I'm sure it affects some. A lot of commercial beekeepers in the US, though, will opt for 9-frame hives. 9 frames and 10-frame box just because it's easier. So I'm sure there is some truth to maybe the optimal is 10 frames, but we kind of get away with a little more, a little less. But yes, that when it's bowed, that definitely makes a difference. Yeah.
If cost is a problem, how do they extract the honey? Is it before the centrifuge?
They'd still often use the centrifuge. They'd have knives. One of the guys said, I really wish I could have a portable like bee wax melting device to decap stuff. And I took a look at his knife and I said, well, you know, we need to get you a knife sharpener. It was true. Although he could really use an electric portable hive decapper, He also needed other tools in the beginning. But yes, they were using the centrifuges for that. That's a good question.
How long have they been using the box, like a Langstroth hive? And who introduced that? Was it English?
So there was an entrepreneur. I actually met the guy, or at least his son, in the northern part of the Indian Punjab. And they got introduced with the European bee and that the so the Langstroth boxes, I believe, in the 70s. And then they've been expanding.
1970s?
When they tried to introduce it to the south, it didn't take, so that's why you still see a lot of the Indian beekeeping. In remote areas, like the Himalayas that I visited, you still see often the native bee. It's often promoted as organic, sells it a little bit higher, especially higher than 85 cents a pound. It also depends on the region. There's differences in the bees that I didn't talk about. The Indian bee likes to swarm, so it's one of those things you put out the box, you put the bees in it, bees swarm away, oh well, you know, too bad. I'll get more bees later. Whereas the European bee doesn't swarm as much, and so you actually migrate around. So it's an interesting difference. Yes?
What do bees cost?
I don't know a good amount of like how much you would pay to get the bees themselves. I do know a lot of them will hunt their own bees. Like they will follow and find native bees that are just out in the environment, swarms, and take care of them. So that's a great question. I wish I knew that number. Yeah.
I was going to ask where they got their bees from.
Yep. A lot of them are either broken off from one other person or they'll go into nature and just find it. They're very brave. Like they thought I was very funny for wearing a half veil. Like it was really warm. Like it was not a practical thing. Like they would just wear their head veil, if that, and wear short sleeves and sandals and shorts, you know, out working their bees. I don't know that they'd ever seen so much as a full half veil, because it was really, really warm. But I remember, I'll tell you one funny story. I asked one of the beekeepers, I actually asked all the beekeepers this, but I asked this one particular beekeeper, I said, what do you enjoy most about beekeeping? He said, my favorite part about beekeeping is getting stung. I said, really? Why is that? And he said, well, that's when I get the honey. So it was a very interesting thing to see. Yes?
You said earlier that they get subsidized. Who subsidizes?
The government, yep.
If the government subsidizes, why doesn't the government, why aren't they able to put in their...
That is a great question. It's a complicated range of forces. If you actually saw a lot of Indian architecture, you know, even the houses are not particularly square, so trying to get the spec for bee boxes is equally challenging. But it's very interesting. Yes.
United States, Canada, and Mexico standardized the size of the Langstroth about 150 years ago. And we don't realize how lucky we are that we only have one size to deal with.
Yes.
Okay, there's the eight frame, but the size of it. Yep. And you can pick up a hive that was 40 years old, and it's still the same size, and everything fits.
It's a big benefit for us that we don't appreciate as much.
Miles ahead.
Yes.
But we don't realize how damn lucky we are. You go to Europe, you can get 15 different sized boxes in one country.
Yep.
The German National, the Swedish National Hive, the Metric Hive, the Langstroth. It's just a big hodgepodge, and India is no different.
Yep.
We're so lucky here that we only got one size to deal with.
Yep. Definitely agree. Any other questions? So I looked at a couple of different kinds of hive scales. I originally looked at the load cell scales, but they were too expensive. I looked at a lot of sort of the half-lift mechanisms, where you sort of pick up half the hive, and then I kind of made, with my advisor, sort of invented another kind. Don't quite recommend for safety reasons, I'll explain why, but it was pretty cool. It was very cool. So if you look at a normal load, like four load cell hive, there's not a lot of inaccuracy in that. Sort of the design, it's very robust to sort of inclination. The mechanism is usually good, but there's one problem, which is drift. So a lot of people don't think about this. They say, oh, I have continuous data, everything's perfect, but you're actually not accounting for variations in temperature and drift over time. So as a researcher, I thought that was potentially important. Haft lift mechanisms, though, suffer from a lot of inaccuracy in the way that they're done. And I have a lot of variables. You have the inclination of the ground that it's very sensitive to. You have where do you place shims if you're trying to lift on one side. So if you're buying something that does one of these things, I highly recommend measuring on one side of your hive, like the left, coming around to the right, and taking another measurement and averaging them. If you lift from the back only, just with the errors, not including the actual device and how it's measuring, you could have a spread of like 12 to negative 18% error just from different parameters of is the bee's mass, center of mass off center, where's your shim and other things. Whereas if you lift from both sides, it's under 5% error, which is at least a little bit better. I looked at a couple of interesting designs. One of them was the one that you see here. It was essentially a little torque wrench that has a little bracket. And you slide it under your hive and you try to twist, and it lifts up your hive just a little bit and you try to measure it. The person hadn't done much of what's called a free body diagram, which is a drawing of your forces. This suffers from a lot of friction. And so friction alone can have, like, it can augment the measurement by as much as like 8%, which is really not good. So if you're going and trying to buy a weight scale, don't really recommend this one. There was a tutorial online for a design that looked like the following. It has a little luggage scale off to the right, has a little pulley with a string, and has a little lever that it tries to pick up. This is a good design, but I have some improvements to it. And again, you want to measure from your left and your right, and you take an average. I could talk a little bit about sort of design improvements and the mechanisms and analysis that go into this, but it can reduce the error down to, I believe, under 5% and get it pretty consistent, which is good. The idea that I had to make things a little bit faster and also be accurate was this design as follows. What happens is you have a clamp. It kind of tries to keep the boxes together because sometimes they like to separate. And you can have a little device that you pull over to the right, you stretch around, you pull over to the left, and you use what's called a you have an equilibrium of torque, and you can actually get a pretty good estimate of what your the weight of your hive is. And so that's a pretty cool mechanism that I don't think people have done before. You need to have special hive stands that aren't going to tip over. And you want to make sure that the bees have really propolized your boxes when you do it. We didn't have any problems. I just want to put a disclaimer. But you can actually see some of the different designs. Your normal four-frame or four-load cell can drift. Probably about 2% is a good estimate. We had somebody come in to talk about their little hive scale that only measured on one side. That's actually not very robust to like where you put it. It's very sensitive to the inclination of your hive. If you moved it too far or too close, did the bees put their honey in the front or the back? So actually, you can have as much as negative 15% error with that. But it's not going to change very quickly over time. So you can see lovely cute graphs online. Just be skeptical if you're a researcher. Torque wrench and bracket, again, like almost 20% error. It's pretty bad. Leverage pull, I have sort of negative 10 to plus 17, but if you optimize it like I did, and you can read about it in my thesis, you can get negative 5 to plus 2% error, which is pretty good. So pretty interesting. The portable scale is one where you take a bathroom scale and you put little edges on it, and you go and you pick up your scale, or you pick up your hive. There's a couple mechanisms to do that. The only problem is you got to be really careful that your hive doesn't fall off your weight scale, because that could be really bad. I've seen some really bad designs online of how to do it, but the nice thing is that it recalibrates when you set your hive down and then you pick it up, and that's what gets it its really good accuracy. So thanks so much. I really appreciate the questions. I'll be up here.